So today our topic is regarding the practical, that is qualitative analysis of abnormal constituents of urine. In the last practical, we already learned regarding the normal constituents of urine. So they are compulsory, so they are found in the urines. Okay, if their concentration is varies, so then only they can denote the various kind of the disorders. But today's abnormal constituents, so they are completely absent, so they are negligibles. Okay, if they are found in the urine during the experiments or during the urine examination, so they are denotes the presence of the disease or disorder or various pathological conditions are occurs in our body, simply because they are not found in urine. So that is the systems of our urinary systems. So in the urine only the normal constituents are found, like maybe inorganic, maybe organic, but never the glucose as a abnormal constituent. It do not present in the urine. If it is present, means so that should be negligible amount. Okay, proteins are not present in our body. If the proteins are present in that is in urine, not they are present. If the proteins present in the urine, means so they are denotes. That was known as the albuminuria. Somewhere maybe problem will be occurs or some pathological conditions, so they are developed, or abnormal physiology will be the develop in our body. That is the indication. So that's why the analysis of urines, it is one of the most important tool. So that was helpful for to know the abnormal physiology. Okay, and also helpful for to know the pathological conditions. For detailed screening, then you can go for the quantitative analysis instead of qualitative. Then go through the blood or go through the urine, then go for the quantitative, how much they are present. Okay, from this practical only you can got certain clue, maybe. Okay, definitely that disorder is there, but the stage of disorder, conditions of disorder, severity of disorder, you do not know. But this practical you should be know the risk factor for that disorders also, due to by qualitative analysis of abnormal instruments in the urine when we are going through the practicals or when we are going through the experiments. But PharmDs in the hospital during the practice, you do not perform any experiment, there is no need. But you have developed or capable to read the reports, because that is the part of the pathology lab to conduct the experiments. But they give the reports, they do not give the remarks, only they give the suggestion. So this content is present. Okay, so according to that report, the doctors, so they can give the medications. Okay, doctor, they find out the what kind of disease or disorder that patient may be suffer. So according to that only the doctors, so they write the medications, then your work is there. Okay, according to that report you should be know what will be happens. Okay, for example, if protein is present, it means that candidate was suffering from the albuminuria, then you should be know. So why the protein was found in the urine? It may be problem related to the kidney, maybe acute kidney disease or maybe chronic. So you can got the clue. Then you got something, the kidney is in problems. Okay, so now that clue will give to you, or it can boost to you to counsel the patients regarding why that kidney was damages, or why the kidney was suffering from the disorder due to that the protein is present in the urine, or in some cases the increased blood pressure is also responsible for improper filtration, because as the pressure is increases, the more pressure was put on the glomerular apparatus, then that function was becomes abnormal, then also some stresses of protein was formed. So that is your work. You can concentrate whether it is related to blood pressure, whether related to the liver malfunction,
or kidney fall functions or CNS or any then related to the any kidney damages, maybe acute or chronic. So like that you can got, then according to that only you counsel. So when you're going through the counseling, so then there is no problem is there. Okay, the blood, you can monitor the blood pressure normal, then you're going for the other biomarker, kidney is normal, liver is normal, then what is the problems? Because doctor, they return the medication, kidney was failed, they give the medication. But whether it is the right, not, it is the, not the right the way. But you should be counseled. Then if it is all is okay, then you go for family history. Okay, because these are abnormalities are depending upon the races also. Okay, if the family history is also negligible, that risk factor is not related to family history, then you can counsel the food styles. Okay, what food they are prefer? They prefer protein rich, they are the athletics. Okay, they prefer the protein food. So already those people, especially for this question for students, that is the boys. So they are going for the gym to make the body build up. Even nowadays the girls are also going for the gyms, okay, to maintain the shape. But were the gym trainer, they prefer some particular type of food. Okay, so such food is also responsible for the protein will be found in the urine, because that is the other food. Okay, so those food our body cannot be accepted. Okay, so that's why they are found in the urine. Or that candidate was only concentrated to lose the body weight vigorously, then he work out more than the normal, then also there is a chance of the protein be found in the urine due to more exercise, more than the normal time for that particular person. Okay, then on that time also the protein is found. Or use of certain medications. Okay, so that is also responsible to the protein should be found in urine. So that's why the counseling is the importance. It can decide whatever the doctor that return the medications, they are suitable, they are correct or not. So that is the work of the family candidate. So they can counsel the patient with the help of the report. So that's why, so whatever interpretations are there from today practical, you should be remembered, you should be recalled. In the future, they will be helpful. So like that, our today practical's aim is to perform the qualitative analysis of abnormal constituents of urine. So these practicals regarding the procedures, so that can taken from the book, that is the S.R. Kale and R.R. Kale. The titles of the book is the Textbook of Practical Biochemistry and Clinical Pathology, Nirali Prakashan, page number 22 to 24. If you have any doubt, then you bring this book, from that book you can got the clearance regarding the procedure, regarding interference, because mistake is commonly happens with the humans and teaches us also human beings. So that is, if you have any doubt, then you can refer this reference. That's why I am putting here the reference. So next one, so regarding the requirements, the apparatus like measuring cylinder, test tubes, holders, beakers, burner, glass rods, urinometers, refractometer, sometimes dipsticks are needed as compared to the performing the practicals or pathological conditions. And regarding chemicals, we require today practical chemicals are Benedict reagents, Fehling's A and Fehling B solution, concentrated HNO3, acetic acid, Rother's mixtures, concentrated ammonia, benzidine solution, then hydrogen peroxide, H2O2, sulfur powder, 10% barium chloride, then sulfosalicylic acid. So these are the most common chemicals. Apart from, many other chemicals are also required. So among them, the few important chemicals are here mentioned here. So these are important chemicals. So they are required for to qualitative analysis of abnormal constituents of the urine. So next, regarding first, you get each and every time of urine analysis, you go for the physical examinations of urine. So in the physical examinations, at least you can monitor the color of the urine, pH of urine, odor of urine, and turbidity. If you still need more information, then you can go for the sedimentation rate of urine, then specific gravity of urine, then volume of urines. Okay, in the critical conditions, okay, in severity conditions, according to severity of the patient, minimum each and every time when you are going through the readings or when you suggest the examinations of urine, at least you can suggest for color, to check the color of urine for pathology lab, and as well as suggest to them to check the pH, odor or turbidity. If still you need more information, then on that time you can go for the sedimentation rate as well as specific gravity, even the volume of urine for 24 hours. That they use the detailed risk factors or any disorder that maybe the person will be suffering. So first, the minimum physical examination should be the color. You can go for the color. Already you know the our color of urine is light straw to amber in color. If the person is well hydrated, so their water intake is accurate, minimum he can got the 8 to 12 glass of water or 3 to 4 liter minimum. Okay, so the water intake, so that can keep the person well hydrated. Okay, if the person's intake of water is less, then on that time the color become the amber, that denotes the person was suffering from the dehydrated. So that's why the urine color is considered as a normal when it is look like a light straw to amber in color. Actually, it is alone color. Okay, then if the urine color is colorless, then it can denote the person is suffering from the fatty related disease. That is the whatever disease are there, so that occur due to accumulations of fat or excess of the fat in the plasma or blood. So on that time our urine color become the colorless, so that can be denoted. If it is colorless when you are observed, then it denotes the person was suffering from the fatty diseases as well as diabetes mellitus or polyuria. So these are the conditions or inference, so that can denoted. So when the urine color is a colorless, if the urine color is yellowish brown, so that indicates the presence of bile pigment or fever, or even it can denote the GIT bacterial infections. Then only the bile pigments will be the found in the urine when we are suffering from the bacterial infections of the GIT, okay, gastrointestinal tract, or even in the case of fever, then the urine color become the yellowish brown, then reddish brown, that it denotes the presence of hemoglobin in a urine. Hemoglobin is a protein, okay, that denotes the presence of hemoglobin urines, or hemorrhage in the kidney, due to that the urine containing the blood, that due to that the color becomes reddish brown, or menstrual contaminations in the female. Okay, we also remember if any menstrual contamination is there, so they any girls or female, they having the abnormal menstrual cycle, so during the abnormal menstrual cycle the blood can be excess, can be lost, so on that time so the urine color become the reddish brown. That is also can point out if the urine color is found to reddish brown and that candidate belong to female or menarche woman. Okay, so when it is reddish brown, you can consider also that female whether having the menstrual period or not. Okay, the first 1 to 3 days or 5 days the menstrual flow is present in the menarche women or females, so that is also consider. Otherwise you don't go for the kidney was damages. If the menstrual cycle is present, means that urine may be menstrual contaminated, so that's why it is look like a reddish brown. Okay, next one, if it is look like a milky, then it is consider the presence of the fat. That is dark yellow, then denotes the only fever, then dark green, that denotes the typhoid and cholera. It means regularly in summer and in winter, then in rainy season you observe your urine, because in summer and in rainy season, on that season only we are suffering from the typhoid, and typhoid occurs only when So when we were prefer the contaminated drinking water, but nowadays we all are drinking the purified water. That's why there is no chance for the typhoid fever. So dear students, once again I suggest you, I inform to you, if you have the fever, so then it cannot belong to typhoid nowadays in the present COVID era. Because if your water is not contaminated, that is not a typhoid. Because all people there believe that in the summer definitely the person was suffering from the typhoid. Okay, if you are having, now you are having the fever, means you do not think or do not insist to that patient you are having the typhoid fever, you don't worry, you do not have the COVID. You counsel that person how water intake is there. He only prefer the demineralized water, okay, filter water means, so that is not the typhoid fever. There is a take the risk regarding the COVID-19. Okay, once we go for the COVID test in early stage, you do not judge it is a typhoid. Because in present condition, maximum in the villages, so they are thinking it is a typhoid fever. Okay, so now you are hearing the news regarding the various the mortality in the Nanded. That is a mistake notion. They are thinking it is a typhoid. They are taking the treatment for typhoid, but it is not typhoid, it is a COVID-19. So that's why I inform to you, you can do not judge, you can counsel. And also you can monitor the urine. If it is dark green means it is typhoid, if it is not means it is not a typhoid. Okay, that may be any related other. And in summer also, in the evening time, the body temperature increases. That is also considered in the point. Otherwise, you are touching your skin in the evening time, it is raises the certain some temperature. Okay, that is also some point you can consider regarding the final decision to take regarding the fever related to COVID or many other conditions. Okay, so then if it is black, it is indicates the presence of melanin, or the person was suffering from the melanoma or homogenistic acid in the alkaputone urea. So they went that on that time only, so our urine color becomes the black. So this is the regarding the color. If any variation, then it can denote the these following disorders or abnormal conditions. So next one, so regarding you go for the odor. So actually, so normal odor of urine is aromatic in nature. On long standing, so urine, it becomes the ammoniacal odors. Okay, so that it indicates that was the normal urines. Okay, if it is fruity odor, okay, of a urine, it is having the fruit like smell. Okay, so that indicates the person was suffering from the ketosis, excess of ketone bodies excreted from the urine. So that on that time only our urine odor become the fruity like odor. And if it is cabbage type odor, that denotes the methionine mal absorption. So methionine cannot be absorbed, methionine is an amino acid, so they cannot be absorbed. So due to mal absorption of methionine, so on that time it can found in the urine. So on that time the odor of the urine is the cabbage type odor. Then maple sugar odor, it denotes the maple sugar urine disease. So that on that time the urine is look like a this in the second jar, the first jar, so it is the normal urine. In the second jar, it is look like a this. It denotes that person was suffering from the maple sugar urine diseases, that is MSUD. Then mousy, it can denote the presence of the phenylketone urea. Okay, if it is rancid in color, that is the when due to acidity. Okay, when you are eating the puranpoli, so on that time some another type of odor is occurs in our oral cavity, that is the failure of the eye. Okay, that is the rancidity. If same odor, if it is occurs when you observe the urine, means so that denotes the presence of the tyrosine in urine. So on that time it is having the odor like a rancidity and foul. It can denotes the urinary tract infection or vaginitis. So on that time the urine become the more dirty, that is a foul like odor. So that can denote the person was suffering from the UTI or vaginitis. So next one, you can go for the pH. or to check the reactions pH. So actually the pH of urine is 5.5 to 6.5, so it is considered as normal. If it is acidic, then it denotes the person was suffering from the diabetes mellitus, ketoacidosis, prolonged starvation, febrile illness in the children, or strenuous exercise. Okay, so on that time only, the more protein is released. On that time only, the urine pH become the acidic. Okay, so these are the conditions. So that can denoted with the help of by monitoring the pH of urine, if the urine pH is the acidic. Then if it is the alkaline, that can denote the severe vomiting or diarrhea, hyperventilation, or prolonged use of the diuretic drugs. So on that time, so our urine pH become the alkaline. So this point is also, you consider when the patient urine pH is alkaline, then you counsel that you have any vomiting in the last night. If it is not, means it's okay. Any diarrhea in the last 24 hours, if it is okay, means that is due to that urine alkaline is due to diarrhea. If it is not, then hyperventilation, so more ventilation is there, due to that also alkaline. Then whether the candidate are using diuretic drugs or not. If it is using diuretic drug, means so that alkaline pH is related to the use of the diuretic drugs. So these points will be helpful for the counseling. Next one, regarding the turbidity, actually the urine is look like a clear and transparent, that was considered as the normal. If the urine is look like a cloudy, so then it can denote the presence of the large amount of phosphate, carbonate, urate, or even it can denote the presence of the WBC, RBC, oxalate, or maybe pus cells or pus tissues and bacteria. So on that time only, after waiting, it becomes the cloudy in appearance. So that denote the patient, maximum cases, the patient or person was suffering from the bacterial infection, or maybe WBC present or RBC. Actually, the WBC and RBC are absent, if they are present, or maybe excess of phosphate and carbonate or urate. And further, you can go for the abnormal testings. So then you can conclude whether it is related to the excess of phosphate, carbonate or urate, or related to the bacteria or WBC and RBC. So these are the various physical examinations. So they can go through the during the urine analysis. So now we can go for the biochemical examinations of urine regarding the abnormal contents of urine. Commonly, you can go for the estimations of abnormal contents like a glucose or presence of protein in the urines, ketones, bile pigments, and bile salts. So at least, so these components you should be examined, because these are not present in the normal urine, only in the abnormal physiology and pathological conditions. So then only, so these abnormal constituents, so they are found in the urine. First, we can go for the test for reducing sugar or glucose. For that purpose, we are using the two tests. One is the Benedict test, another one is the Fehling test. So in the Benedict test, you should be take the 5 ml of Benedict reagent in a test tube, then add 2 ml of urine sample or 8 drops of urine sample. Okay, in some book they are mentioned 2 ml, in some book they are mentioned the 8 drops of urine sample, and boil it. And after 1 to 2 minutes, it can absorb regarding the color green or yellowish green, orange or red precipitate, you can observe. If these color are produced, then it indicates the presence of glucose. Okay, the urine, it can contain the reducing sugar or glucose is present in the urine. And the color precipitate observation during the Benedict test, so they also helpful for to know the concentrations of glucose in the urines. If the precipitate is green, that indicates 0.5% glucose is present in the urine. If it is yellow precipitate, that denotes that is the 1% glucose is present in urine. Then if it is orange precipitate, it denotes 1.5% of glucose is present in the urine. If it is brick red precipitate is found during the observation during the Benedict test, then it can denote the glucose is present 2 or more%, that is a serious conditions. Okay. And second test regarding the test for reducing sugar is, that is the Felling test. So here to take 2 ml of Felling A, 2 ml of Felling B solution, boil for few minutes. So after that, add 2 to 3 ml of urine and boil again. And note down whether the yellow PPT appears or not appears. If it is not appears, the glucose is not confirmed. So that first test is fail. Many abnormalities are there. If it is yellow PPT appears, then glucose is confirmed. So like that, the Felling test is helpful for the confirmations of the presence of the glucose in the urine by using the Felling A and Felling B solution. So next, regarding the clinical interpretations, if the glucose is found in the urine, it denotes the person was suffering from the glucosuria. So the glucose is present in urine in the following cases, like diabetes mellitus, hypoadrenalism, that is the malfunctions of adrenal gland, and renal glucosuria. So these are three conditions in which the glucose is found in the urine, due to diabetes mellitus or renal glucosuria, or maybe malfunctions of the adrenal gland, that is the hypomal functions. Okay, so on that time only the glucose it was found in the urines. So next one, the test for proteins. So proteins can be confirmed in the urine by using the three tests: sulfosalicylic acid test, Heller's nitric acid ring test, and heat coagulation test. Okay, so regarding the sulfosalicylic test, so here you can use the 3 ml of urine and add few drops of sulfosalicylic acid. Okay, if you note down, if the white PPT is not appear, then it can denote the albumin is absent. If white PPT is appears, means the albumin is present. Through the sulfosulfuric acid test, by observing the white PPT appearance, it can confirm the albumin is present in the urine. Regarding the in the Heller's nitric acid ring test, take 3 ml of concentrated HNO3 in a test tube and add urine drop wise side of the test tube that can containing the 3 ml of the concentrated HNO3, and note down whether the white ring is found between two fluids or not. If it is not formed, albumin is absent. If the white ring is formed between the concentrated HNO3 and urine, that denotes the presence of ring, that denotes the albumin is confirmed. Confirmedly, the albumin as a protein, it is present in the urine. So next one, so regarding the heat coagulation test, fill 3/4 of the test tube with the urine sample, then heat the top of the test tube and observe it. So then add 1 to 2 drops of acetic acid to it and again observe. If any white coagulum or turbidity is obtained, means it can confirm the urine can containing the albumin. If it is not any coagulum, then the albumin is not present. So like that, these three tests, it can helpful for the qualitative analysis of the abnormal constituents like protein, whether it is present in urine or not. So next one, regarding the clinical interpretations regarding the test for protein. So the presence of detectable amount of protein in urine is known as the protein. It means only if the protein is present in urine, means that was known as the proteinuria conditions. So regarding the physiological proteinuria, if it is less than 0.5% gram, it occurs due to severe exercise, pregnancy, high protein diet, etc. So where only the protein is present, but that should be the less than 0.5 gram. And regarding the pathological variations, it can denote the kidney was damaged, that is regarding the glomerular nephritis, nephrotic syndrome, or in some patient they are suffering from the multiple diseases such as leukemia, lymphoma, sarcoma. So these are the various interpretation that can be concluded with the help of the test for protein in the urine. So next one, regarding the test for ketones, for that purpose we are using the Rother's test. So where saturate 5 ml of urine with the Rother's mixture and then add 1 to 2 ml of concentrated ammonia solution and gently mix by rotation and allow the stand for few minutes and observe it. If any permanganate color or deep purple ring is observed at the junctions of two layers, means so that can confirm the acetone is present or acetoacetic acid is present. So therefore the urine is containing the ketone bodies. If any no color, then it is denotes the ketone bodies are absent. So regarding the clinical interpretations, so acetoacetic acid or beta hydroxy butyric acid or acetones are collectively known as the ketone bodies. Okay, so normal urine of 24 hours may contain ketone bodies up to 1 mg. So excess of ketone bodies, if it is more than 1 mg, it is found in the blood, means so that condition was known as the ketonemia. And also the higher expression ketone bodies in urine is also known as the ketonuria, or overall it is known as the ketosis. And ketone bodies, so they are found in the urine during the fasting, because ketone bodies are the energy rich biomolecule. So during fasting or deficiency of glucose, so automatically the ketone bodies are produced, okay, to balancing the energy level in our body. Or also untreated diabetes mellitus or high uncontrolled sugar level, so were also the ketone bodies, so they are found in the urine. Or high fat intake, low carbohydrates diets, prolonged starvation, pregnancy and lactation, so where the ketone bodies are found in the urine. So that's why you do not go for unrelated starvations or fasting, otherwise our kidney will be damaged or the ketone bodies, so they are found in the urine. So next one, regarding the test for blood, so that was tested with the help of the benzidine test. Take 2 ml of urine in a test tube and boil for 5 minutes and cool it. And after that, mix equal volume of benzidine solution, that is 2 to 3 ml, and also hydrogen peroxide in a test tube, and add the boiled cooled urine into the test tube and note down the color. If blue color is produces, means, and later on it turns to green, means it indicates the blood is present or the urine can contain the blood. If it is no color change, then it can denotes the blood is the absent. So regarding the clinical implications, so actually the urine do not contain any RBC, only few leukocytes, epithelial cells may be present. Okay, so during estimations of blood in the urine, it can denotes the conditions like hematuria and hemoglobinuria. So in the case of hematuria, so where the conditions in which the RBC is present in the urine, and it can denotes the acute glomerular nephritis, stone in kidney, ureter, or renal tuberculosis, or carcinoma kidney, where only the blood in urine test is the positive, otherwise it is the negative. And also it can be helpful for to denote the hemoglobinuria, so that can denote the other the patients are suffering from the malaria or typhoid, hemolytic jaundice, yellow fever, or intravascular hemolysis, are due to mismatch blood transfusion and autoimmune hemolytic disease. So these all are confirmed. So when the test for blood in urine, that should be the positive. So were only, so these disorder may be the patient will be the having. So next one, so regarding the test for bile salts and bile figments, so that was confirmed with the help of the hay sulfur powder test and pouch test. So in the hay sulfur powder test, take 3 ml of urine in a test tube, sprinkle the pinch of sulfur powder on a test tube and observe it. If the sulfur powder sinks to the down or bottom of the test tube, it denotes the bile salts are confirmed or present. Actually the sulfur powder in the urine, in the normal urine, it can be float. If it is sink to down or settle to down, that can denote the bile salts are present, so they are confirmed. So regarding the pouch test, so take 3 ml of urine solution in a test tube and add 2 ml 10% of barium chloride until the thick white precipitate is obtained. So after that, filter it, and to the precipitate on the filter paper, add few drops of pouch reagent and observe. If the color changes yellow to pista green, then it can denotes the bile pigments are present. If there is no change of yellow color to pista green, that denotes the bile pigments are absent. So like that, so these two tests, so they are helpful for the determinations of the bile salts and bile pigments in the urine. So regarding the clinical interpretations, the bile salts are sodium potassium salts of glycocholates and taurocholates. If they are found in urine, means so they can denote the obstructive jaundice or hemolytic jaundice. So on that time only the bile pigments and bile salts, so they are found in the urines. Okay, so remaining we can discuss.